Hi, I'm Vanessa, and I love bad Star Trek. I will be the string quartet stuck on the poop deck that is Star Trek Picard, and today I will be talking to you about an episode called No Win Scenario. What I can of it anyway, there really isn't much there. In fact, season 3 of Picard hasn't had a lot going on, even in the episode after this one. And why would you choose to keep a plot in a state of suspended animation for at least 50% of the final season of the final series that these characters will be featured in? One might look at the start of my channel and be convinced that I hate TNG, but that could not be further from the truth. TNG is one of the best series, in part of because of its ability to succinctly tell a story per episode or over the course of a few episodes. And by doing that, it keeps its shit in neat little piles that you can just jump right over, whereas in Picard, it smears it across entire seasons. I will give it to season 2 of Picard for being about things like Q's eventual death, Rios deciding the temporal prime directive doesn't really apply to him or whatever. There was still so much in the way of diversions, MacGuffins, Orama, and plot contrivances, but I could at least connect with the characters through the chaos. Seven felt present. Picard felt alive. Guinan was very much herself. In season 3, though, not only do they get basic characterizations completely wrong, but it's also more padded than my fifth grade bra, which was done for purely pain relief related reasons. It was agonizing. And so is this. So far, Beverly Crusher sent a message to Picard to save her and trust no one, especially in Starfleet. And he trusts Riker, who is a captain in Starfleet, immediately. And they hatch this stupid plan to board and commandeer the Titan, a Starfleet ship. And they ask the captain to take him out of Federation space because that's where Beverly is. And he says no, looks like an asshole for saying no. And Seven, Captain Shaw's first officer, also thinks he's an asshole. So she steals the Titan while the captain is asleep. And they go to this nebula outside of Federation space. Picard and Riker get a shuttle, grabs Bev and some guy named Jack, gets all of them beamed aboard. And so now they're all being chased by whoever's after Jack, some lady named Vodic, in a ginormous, bigly gunned ship named the Shrike that just chooses not to destroy Beverly's ship while the Titan is on the way and beam Jack out if that's who they're after. And then it doesn't destroy the Titan and beam Jack out. So it was laughably dumb as shit to see this super intimidating villain be like, you have 1 hour to hand Jack over. Like, what is going on? What's going on is they didn't have a plan for this season, obviously. And that's evident here because in an effort to elude the Shrike and get out of the nebula, they've gotten sucked into some gravity well, and it's a nesting doll of anomalies in this thing. What I did like about this episode is that it starts with Picard imparting something valuable to a group of enthusiastic cadets about how to rely on your crew to get out of sticky situations. Not just because it was a characteristic show of wisdom, but that it deliberately subverts the audience's expectation of Picard getting to finally brag about his exploits by showing Picard taking the focus off of himself as the lesson. That's the guy I know. This guy, Justice, humble and committed to the truth. And then we're back on the bridge with Riker, who realizes that Timmy the Titan is stuck down a well and they barely have any power left to even run life support on, never mind do anything to push themselves out of the well. And this entire bridge crew of the Titan, a ship Riker has lightly gotten out of worse situations than this, is just throwing in the towel. Not a single peep about a possible solution from anybody on the bridge crew. Nothing. Even Sydney LaForge, who reminds us every 2 seconds that she is Geordi LaForge's daughter.
But if we pull any more power from our engines, there will be zero chance we can fly out of here.
Just divert everything to life support and get out the string quartet, you guys. We hit an iceberg and we're going down.
We're sinking.
Even though it's space and you literally cannot. So interestingly, this actually means that Picard was wrong, that you actually can't rely on your crew, except to look up helplessly as they walk away from even attempting to get you out of a hole that only gets deeper with every passing second. Lassie's not coming. Just lay down and die. I mean, most bridge crews in Kurtzman Trek are rather indistinct and entirely ineffectual by design so that they can highlight the heroic exploits of one or two people, which is pretty annoying. But what Picard has always done in particular is create transparently contrived reasons for the story to either advance or pause. And by keeping the Shrike out of striking distance because gravity well, and the Titan being the Titanic for the time being, it forces the crew to take the time to reflect as they pretty much do everything except brainstorm a solution to this problem. Guys, it's literally not even halfway through. We know that they're going to make it. So this is super unnecessary. And instead of exploring what those electric waves are about, because the answer is right there, Riker's told to make sure to lower shields in between hits, and he instantly turns around to apologize to Picard for kicking him off the bridge before, saying that it was just a matter of time before they're all crushed anyway, and the Titan's just dead.
The Titan's dead in the water. We estimate about 4 hours until the ship is crushed by the gravity well.
And Picard just accepts it, like, well, that's all she wrote. Not a flicker of an idea behind those eyes, just pure defeat. Like they all secretly had a death wish from the very beginning. 6 minutes in, and they just give up. Classic Trek. It's like a mirrorverse version of Balance of Terror. Why build tension when you can just fart it all out right at the beginning? Granted, Riker gives one of the most heartbreaking revelations ever after that about the death of his son Thaddeus, but I can't help but wonder why his lack of faith in an afterlife is something that Troy would be surprised by.
And yet there's nothing that proved to me that there is anything after. And I've tried to shake that. Deanna, as you know, feels everything, but she couldn't live with me feeling nothing.
Why would she expect a person raised in the Federation on Earth to be super religious in the first place? Picard season 3 takes place 5 years after their son's death, so it took her that long to say, hey, you don't believe in heaven, get out? Like, never mind the decades prior that perhaps the subject of faith might be broached. This is a waking nightmare, I swear, especially when Riker quotes the Doors.
This is the end, my friend.
It's not even one of their better songs, you know? Like, Jim Morrison went on some repetitive, rambly, go-nowhere diatribes, but some of it slapped, and I will die on that hill. The end is not the one. And the reason he even shared that horrible thing was because he was giving Picard a pep talk to go talk to his son. Oh yeah, Beverly and Picard apparently had a fling, and Beverly sprung it on him like hours before that he even had a son at all that she was keeping from him for no defensible reason, and angrily threw it in his face as though he was deliberately absent, even though it was her that decided to randomly disappear from Starfleet and Earth like a scared teenager for 20 years to do medical philanthropy, but did so to protect her son, even though he's fully a wanted weapons dealer now. Keep the random familial connections with the Habsburgs and Star Wars, you guys. Introducing new characters in your final season is pretty hanky to begin with because of the limitations. He's consigned to being a mindlessly adversarial plot device. He too has a chip on his shoulder, and when it comes to Picard, Will Riker hating Kyle Riker because he was abandoned as a teenager made perfect sense. But it doesn't make sense at all for Jack, his son who was weirdly named after Beverly's first husband, to hold a grudge at all. Picard had no idea he even existed. So where is this hostility even coming from? And because that anger prior had no grip on reality, it can easily shift. There's no foundation of a character we can trust. So at this point, they're chill enough to hang out in 10 forward and have a beer, I guess. What frustrates me about this conversation is that there is so much ground to cover. Like, what could they possibly accomplish in a single conversation, even if it went amazingly? What connection could possibly be created or destroyed? There's no stakes here. They literally just met and they're going to die anyway. So what's the point of drinking synthahol in a simulation of a bar he definitely doesn't care about?
This is a place of real significance for me. But I don't suppose you've ever...
I haven't.
Since they're definitely all going to survive, though, the goal of this conversation must be, narratively, to squeeze the zit that is Jack so that he can, after two episodes of silence, explain his reasons for not reaching out to his father after he found out who his dad was, or maybe have a chat about why the Shrike is after him because Federation wouldn't give money bounties and roguish medical philanthropy doesn't really explain why a warship is after him. So what do you gotta lose? You're in a perfect situation to just spill your guts. Nah, you can't do that because this is the fourth episode of the last season. You can't possibly advance a plot or develop a character. Why do that when you can just interrupt your own story to look for a changeling aboard your ship? And why is it news to Seven, the first officer aboard the Titan, that changelings need their buckets to sleep, even though she's an ex-Borg and definitely has lots of information about other species already? But we gotta cut to the Shrike to have a bit of a Dr. Claw from Inspector Gadget type scene. So we find out the captain of the Shrike is an underling to somebody else. And who might that be? My theory is Baylock, the little guy from Carbamite Maneuver, or Lost, that changeling that was a total jerk to Odo for no reason. Like, again, we don't find out here because the show is determined to keep everything a mystery when you have, no time left for people to become invested in anything. We're back with Jack Jr. in 10 Forward, though, where Picard thinks he can convince someone to have a relationship with him. In response, Jack does his best Chakotay impression.
I get that you might think that I need this, that this might make it all better somehow, but I don't. I grew up mostly on my own. Sure, I had my mother, but that's who I am.
I have no reason to be adversarial towards you, but I've just decided to be.
You don't want to get mixed up with a guy like me. I'm a loner, Daddy. A rebel.
A rebel without a cause. Again, shocker. Just as shocking as it is for Beverly to be a cliche machine after a newly discovered changeling kills a fellow officer.
And things are about to get a lot worse.
Or as much as Picard recalling a time when they were powerless and stuck, as the Titan currently is, and figured out a solution.
A micrometeoroid shower hit the shuttle at high speed. It wrecked us. Instantly, we were blind, powerless, and running out of air. We were dead in the water. But we improvised a system, swapped the remaining power between docking thrusters and life support.
How is the situation in the Titan hopeless, but the one in the shuttle where they were having the same problem, fine, and they could figure it out? And just before Jack is about to spill the tea on what exactly his mother told him about his dad, Shaw walks in, who's been injured. He has given command to Riker as a result, and he takes that particular opportunity to nail Picard to a cross by bringing up the cute little memory of Picard being assimilated by the Borg and the subsequent attack on Wolf 359. Where Shaw was one of the survivors.
He was on that Borg cube, setting the world on fire!
So here's a question. Why the hell would he have a Borg first officer then? It's just perfect to have someone you fundamentally don't trust at all as someone you must rely on to captain your shit if shit goes down, which is what the Titan is doing this episode, by the way. Maybe they could focus on that instead of shit that can't be helped. But this episode is all about blowing gust after gust of hot air while the entire crew is burping pointlessly in a hologram of a bar about the past. I really enjoy Shaw as a character. He functions as a reasonable counterpoint to the terrible decision making on the show, but this monologue doesn't accomplish anything either. He would know better than to actually blame Picard for what happened. Like, contrast this with Captain Sisko, whose wife died for the same reason. He didn't exactly blame Picard outright because it's illogical to do so. People don't usually volunteer to become assimilated into the Borg, but he wasn't exactly really angling to be best buddies either. And not only that, why would it be news to the crew? It's a pretty infamous incident. Not far-fetched for it to be considered common knowledge in Starfleet. All this does is make Shaw look like someone who can't let shit go, and that's his problem with Picard, and not that he and his first officer conspired to steal a ship to fly it out of Federation space while he's sleeping. Which is mutiny! But before we process any of Jack's possible change in perspective towards his daddy-o for killing 11,000 people, we gotta have Beverly Crusher, the science gal, finally get around to figure out how they can get out of this gravity well aside from lying there and doing absolutely nothing. Because she noticed, get this, a pattern in the electric waves.
Contractions? You mean like a birth? Of what?
Ugh, I don't know.
They seem like contractions. Woman stuff. I swear to God, if this is a pro-life episode, I'm gonna jump out my third story window. So they're getting born, as Anthony Kiedis would put it. Getting born in the state of Mississippi. Not to beat a dead horse about the pacing, but Jack being the first person to talk about these electric waves as something they could harness to extract power from, with Picard, Riker, Shaw, and Seven, and Geordi LaForge's daughter on board is asinine. So of course this is Picard season 3, so this must cause yet another pointless argument that just eats up time.
This is insane. To get up to speed, we need to fire thrusters, which will drain life support in minutes.
But it's possible that we could absorb some of that energy. Use it.
What about the asteroid field that's out there?
Riker not trusting Picard and Beverly's judgment is just whack, plain and simple. It is a risk to surf these waves to get out of a gravity well, but they're going to die if they don't do anything anyway. So what's the point of just sitting there? Riker refusing a solution to this issue, to lie down there and die, is not the Riker I know at all. It's this guy right here. He gets shit done. But Beverly, the old psych, does the old psychology trick of triangulating someone that isn't there. What would Deanna think? Deanna would think you're a damn idiot for whittling soap while the ship is going down. Shaw would not have given command to Riker had he known this would be the outcome. But then Beverly goes, hey, here's an idea. Why don't we do our fucking jobs?
Look where we are. Here. All of us. In this moment. So let's do what we spent our entire lives learning to be great at.
As we have gotten out of so many other things far worse than this. Because that's obvious as shit. Picard even says we've been here before. And he's right. Not to bring up pacing again, but maybe don't drag ordinary Star Trek problems like nebulas and gravity wells for half of your last season ever. The only part of this episode that I enjoyed was Picard getting his dig in with Shaw as he's asking him to retrofit the nacelles to be able to channel the energy coming off of the waves.
Captain Shaw, I realize that I'm the last person you want to see right now, but I need your help, despite the fact that you are indeed a dipshit from Chicago.
As a fellow dipshit from Chicago, I'm just so into this. But it's for dramatic effect, as is Ensign LaForge calling Seven Commander Hansen, which gives her away as the changeling, just in the nick of time for both nacelles to be open. And in keeping with the theme of trust and the anecdote shared before about Jack and Picard flying blind to the Stargazer in a shuttle, they fly out of the asteroid field together. If they had been through so many more things like this, their changing relationship would make much more sense. And I love that the slider for life support to be completely on offline and right there on the bridge. Like, what if Shaw tripped and fell? This Titan retrofit is bogus. But they hotwire their ship and get out of the well by surfing on the energy wave, and they got just enough juice to throw a big ass rock at the Shrike as they exit the nebula using the tractor beam. So the Shrike's disabled and they're like, free amongst the space jellyfish, hearkening back to the episode mentioned earlier about Encounter and Farpoint. The energy wave charged their warp core, and so they split, and that's kind of it. And like, they were in the nebula for 3 whole episodes and spent an entire episode forfeiting the fate of their ship to an easily solvable problem. And we finally get an answer to why Jack didn't approach Picard in a flashback where Jack is wearing a disguise. Like, why would he do that? He would never be recognized. Picard doesn't know him at all. And he's like, hey, Picard, Starfleet's your family, but do you have like a real family?
Young man, Starfleet has been the only family I have ever needed.
Of course, Picard says Starfleet's the only family I need because he has absolutely no idea that he has a son at all. So that's a natural response to a weird and rather prodding question from a complete stranger. So for Jack to be pissed off at him for that answer is absolute nonsense. It's hilarious that Picard bookends the episode with questions that could easily be answered much sooner than this. Who is Vadic? What does she want with Jack? Like, ugh, as Jack sees some weird visions. So he's nuts, and the track record with mental health in this show isn't great, obviously, since Picard's mom was thrown in a hole for a good portion of season 2 for being mentally unwell. A bit draconian, since they were also Federation citizens, but whatever. I don't hate watch this show by any stretch, and I don't dismiss Kurtzman Trek wholesale. Prodigy and Strange New Worlds are killing it. And I might sound like a broken record here, but these are the last few episodes we have with these characters, at least in live action, so it's just a shame that they didn't spend their time a bit more wisely and not retcon their characters to be freaking quitters. Because it's quite clear that this was not planned ahead of time, and if it was planned this way, are y'all okay? Except for the first episode, this entire season 3 could go on my channel. Seriously. It doesn't get better from here, and unless the season ends with a bang, I don't have a lot of high hopes. Because the retconning continues from here, Geordi comes back, and it's downright depressing, and the only thing they could do to save it is to make it even more absurd. Tuvix is in Section 31, Riker goes back in time and has sex with Laxana to be his own grandpa. You know, just go all out. Who cares? It's almost enough to make me headcanon this entire season into oblivion. Like, subscribe, no pressure, but peer pressure. Till next time, I guess.